The presentation will now be done by Carlota Montesinos. She is our specialist in our lab in serology and mycology. She has taken in charge all the needed mission in the field of COVID-19 serology during this pandemic, like validation of new tests and research, and was a member of our crisis committee. Olivier van den Lent, behind this teaching and research skill and member of our crisis committee, I would like to define him as our network contact in Belgium, Europe, and abroad with colleagues, but also many others, companies, politics, and so on. Thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction and for the opportunity to present you the assessment of SARS-CoV-2 infection among healthcare workers. Over the next 20 minutes, we will first describe the context in which we have decided to launch the assessment study of SARS-CoV-2 infection among healthcare workers. Next, we will present you the contribution of the LHUB-ULB in the validation of the different immunoassays, which make possible to start the seroprevalence studies presented today. Before to describe the perspective of our finding, we will briefly describe the contribution of the LHUB-ULB in the fight against COVID in low-resource setting. Then, we will end by concluding remarks. Let's start with the context of this study. As you can see on this figure, in March, we were facing a sharp increase of COVID-19 cases in Belgium. At that time, we were considering the fear of the healthcare worker working and fighting against COVID in the different unit, and also the fear to spread the infection into their house, but also into the community. It is why we decided to start a study helping them to respond to their fears, and we propose to do a study in Saint-Pierre University Hospital with three different objectives: to provide an estimate of the seroprevalence at baseline among high-risk healthcare workers, to determine the prospectively the incidence of new SARS-CoV-2 infections among high-risk healthcare workers, and to estimate the healthcare worker exposure to the virus by serological data to help our five partners hospital in their day-to-day management on the ongoing pandemics. But this study was planned as follows. We plan to do a serological test at this level, combined with the RT-PCR, but also in collaboration with the Faculty of Medicine, with Arnaud Marchand. We also did sampling for more developed immune response analysis. This part will not be described here. We plan to do an additional test in 15 days after the enrollment of the patient, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, and 6 months later. But before to start the study, we had to validate different immunoassays available at that time in the market. And I will give the floor to Carlota to describe this part.
Thank you. serological test were developed as a complementary tool for the diagnosis and control of the COVID-19 infection. Many of these tests were already on the market and accessible in China from the beginning of the pandemic in different formats, ELISA, CLIA, or rapid test. In Europe, only Euroimmune had developed an ELISA test at that moment. In collaboration with the microbiology department of St. Luc Hospital, we could compare Euroimmune with Magrumi test, a random access CLIA, also available in Europe at that moment. In the course of this evaluation, we were also asked to evaluate some lateral flow assay, even more available in Europe, most of them from China, other from local manufacturing, such as Quicksen. That is how this collaborative work came up, allowing us to have a first picture of what we could expect from this test, from this type of test. In this first work, we tested 128 serums from SARS-CoV-2 infected patients, confirmed by PCR, and 72 non-SARS-CoV-2 residual serum samples from pre-COVID-19 period, with a potential cross-reaction to the SARS-CoV-2 immunoassays, as you can see in the slide. The overall performances of the test are summarized in this table. In short, the higher sensitivity was observed with Euroimmune, but in contrast, the specificity was greater with Magrumi, reaching 100%. As you can see, the results for the lateral flow assay show it a similar overall sensitivity of around 70%, and the specificity of this test were excellent, reaching 100% for Labon, Dymoc, and Quicksen. In this slide, we show you the performances of the test at different moments post-symptoms. Excellent sensitivity of around 90-93% was observed for all tests after 14 days for post-symptoms. So, this first study shows us the accurate and equivalent performances of Euroimmune, Magrumi, and the three lateral flow tests in detecting SARS-CoV-2 antibodies 14 days after the onset of COVID-19 symptoms, making them compatible for application in the clinical context and in epidemiological strategies. In fact, we choose Euroimmune IgG for the seroprevalence study. Shortly after, different commercial serological tests for automatic analytical platform were available on the market. In a second study led by my colleague Fleur Wolf, we compared the performances of four automatic immunoassays detecting different classes of immunoglobulins, as you can see in the table. Elecsys of Roche Diagnostics, detecting total antibodies, Liaison of Diasoran, detecting only IgG, Euroimmune IgG and IgA, and Vidas of Biomedieu, detecting IgG and IgM. The characteristic of this test also differ in the principal detection, potential antigens used for serodiagnosis, sample throughput, and the time of results, allowing laboratories to choose the best one suited to each laboratory analysis demand. As we show you in this slide, the performances are similar for all tests. However, Roche and Euroimmune show it the best sensitivity after 15 days post-symptoms or post-PCR. The specificity was 100% for Roche, Vidas IgG, and Vidas IgM. So after these two evaluations and taking into account the performances, the characteristic of the test and the characteristic of our laboratory, we decided to choose Roche Elecsys for SARS-CoV-2 serological test in routine. As you know, until early June, the Belgian laboratories were not able to perform SARS-CoV-2 serological tests in the routine work. And when the long-awaited green light was arrived, we were ready to start. But we come back to the serological study that was on track and this, at this moment. I would like to show you the preliminary results of the study, analyze it and summarize it in this brief report. Here we reported the results obtained between April 15 and May 18, and in this period 326 participants from COVID-19 units and emergency department completed the day one, the baseline visit, and the day 15 visit. So in on one day visit, 37 cases were confirmed by PCR and or serology. So 11.3% of overall population. 10 subjects were diagnosed based on a positive PCR result, and 36 healthcare workers were IgG positive at this moment. That means that the seroprevalence at baseline was 11%. More than 50% of the IgG positive subjects had a previous confirmed COVID-19 diagnosis. In fact, pre-study. 10 healthcare workers were symptomatic at the time of sample collection. On day 15, 6 subjects remained positive on PCR, and 2 new cases were detected by PCR. 3 cases of seroconversion were observed between day 1 and day 15, one of them PCR positive on day 1. So it makes a total of 41 cases of SARS-CoV-2 infection confirmed by PCR and or serology, representing an overall infection rate of 12.6% and a seroprevalence of 12%. This higher seroprevalence in comparison with other studies published at that moment can be explained by the timing, because the present study was initiated 2 weeks after the epidemiological peak. In this period, no seroreversion was observed in this short interval. In this cohort of young and healthy healthcare workers, SARS-CoV-2 infection was mild in the vast majority of cases, and fever was rarely reported. Interestingly, 75% of participants with a positive PCR results were asymptomatic. So this innovative approach allowed the identification of asymptomatic and potentially contagious infected healthcare workers, enabling them to self-isolate for 7 days. Univariate analysis showed that gender, age, type of work, and work unit were not risk factors for infection. That means that the healthcare workers with a direct contact with the infected patients, for example, nurses or doctors, were not at higher risk compared with other members of the staff, administrative staff, for example, suggesting good compliance of control measures. However, the presence of at least one comorbidity and symptoms at the time of sample collection increased the risk of a positive PCR and/or serology test. In conclusion, this approach, along with the strengthening of the control measure, as for example, the universal use of face masks in all hospital units on April the 1st, probably contributed to the control of the nosocomial spread of the virus. And I give the floor to Olivier, who will tell you the continuation of this story.
Thank you very much, Carlotta. Now we will move to the preliminary result of our study after nearly 5 months since the enrollment of the first healthcare worker in our study in mid-April. What we observed after 3 months of follow-up, blood sample collection. First, the PCR results. 52 healthcare workers were found with a positive PCR positive. 29 of them already had a PCR positive before the start of the study, and 23 were positive during the study. Around 39 out of 52 healthcare workers presented persistent positive PCR during around 2 to 3 months. And we also observed that 7 out of 52 PCR positive patients did not develop any IgG, and all of them were asymptomatic. On this figure, you can see the seroprevalence results. 88 healthcare workers developed positive SARS-CoV IgG. 45 of them had a positive PCR result pre-study. Among the 88 healthcare workers, 15 of them presented a disappearance of their antibodies during the study. From month 1 to month 3 of the follow-up visit, 15 of them present a seroreversion. A true zero, any antibodies were detected in 3 of them, and 12 at a borderline detection. Overall, we found a seroprevalence of 12.8% after 3 months of studies. Overall results, PCR combined with serological results. Among the 530 healthcare workers included in our study, 95 SARS-CoV-2 infections were observed between March and August 2020, which represent a cumulative incidence of almost 18%. However, 74 of them were infected before the start of the study. And as you can see on this figure, our results are quite similar as the trends that we observe in our hospital, in the different hospitals. You can see the positivity rate of our PCR results since the beginning of the COVID pandemics, and also the number of tested in our laboratory. The results presented today are quite similar as other European countries, and you can see that in Denmark we have a range of seroprevalence from 1.2 to 11.9, according the type of hospital, but also according the unit in which the healthcare workers are working. We have similar results in Germany, in United Kingdom, and so on. But because one of the vocations of the LHUB ULB is also to support the development of laboratory medicine in low and middle income countries, we decide to support the initiative launched by Dr. Denis Mukwege in his fight against COVID-19 in the province of South Kivu in the Democratic Republic of Congo. To answer the fear of the healthcare worker working in Panzi Hospital, we initiated with the support of Zentech a quite similar study to the one we did in Brussels. And you can see the picture of Panzi Hospital. And after the study started in July and ended in mid-August, and among the 359 healthcare workers enrolled in the study, we found a quite impressive high seroprevalence, which reached 29%, and only 16% of positive healthcare workers reported symptoms of prior COVID illness, suggesting that asymptomatic healthcare personnel could contribute in the SARS-CoV spreading within the hospital, but also into the community. Conclusion. Since April 15, the trends of SARS-CoV-2 infection among COVID healthcare workers working in Saint-Pierre University Hospital seems to follow the national trends. Our results confirm the efficacy of the infection control measures installed in Saint-Pierre University Hospital, but also contributed to the reassurance of the healthcare worker involved at the front line of the fight against COVID-19. At the opposite, our results in Democratic Republic of Congo indicate that the lack of adequate use of personal protective equipment due to the supply shortage led to a high exposure of healthcare workers, but also favored the spreading of the COVID-19 into the community. The perspective. The data provided here represent a valuable source of information for the implementation of surveillance and management strategies for the next phases of the pandemic at the hospital, but also within the community. Since the cohort we built together, we are now able to better understand the natural history of COVID-19 disease. The described studies in this talk provide us the opportunity to reinforce the link with fundamental research laboratories, as we did with Arnaud Marchand in the UAE, by providing the biological material and the linked clinical information. With the recent development in our lab of the plague reduction neutralization assay, the LHB UAB is now ready to better support the clinician in the clinical management of their patients. At the end of this talk, we would like to warmly express our thanks to all individuals of the serology and molecular department of the LHB UAB involved in the study described in this talk and by their involvement in the fight against COVID. We are also grateful to Afid Dama, Fleur Wolf, Christine Gill, Charlotte Martin, Nathan Plumek, who made these studies feasible. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Carlotta and Olivier. Are there questions in the room? No question. Are there questions from the participants? No?
No question. Yeah. The fact that the healthcare workers have the same rate of infection than the general population seems that the contamination is mainly outside the hospital.
Yes. We observe that the protective measure, implemented protective measures, seem sufficiently efficacy to protect the healthcare worker in the fight against COVID. Yes.
I remember that there was, a German publication, given the results from different healthcare workers working in the UCI and the emergency room and in the other wards of the hospitals, and the amount of infection were quite different related to the predictive measure that were installed. Yeah, did you find something like that, or you don't have the data about the origin of the personal staff that were included?
We have to analyze the data, but I don't know if you have already preliminary data, but it's clearly linked according to the unit where they are working, and thanks to collaboration with other hospitals, we will have also additional information for non-COVID unit healthcare worker, and as we have already seen in Democratic Republic of Congo, the fact that just to wear a mask, it's a barrier against COVID and seems to be a good protective measure against to prevent the seroconversions against COVID. So put a mask on your face, please. Also, do the lunch.
Oh, that's much easier. Okay, thank you very much. No other questions. So this session ends, and we will be back in 15 minutes. So this means 15, yeah? So it's 3:45.